Exactly.
It's hard to not finish the level.
Right,
isn't
yeah.
It?
That's it. That's the ad. I don't have to keep playing.
Yeah. Cool, cool. So your ad revenue on that space game is going to start pouring in now.
Yeah, basically.
Okay. Awesome.
Where did you place your ads in Dave in the Cave?
So, like I said, I placed them on the in-between screen.
Oh, okay.
Since he was climbing up and going around and all that other stuff, it was. I didn't want it to be in a place where people could accidentally touch it, because you don't want to annoy your users.
Right, yeah. Another good place that I've heard to put it is in the splash screen, so when your game is loading up, there's a couple seconds there, and if your ad's there, it's going to, you know, it's going to be open every time they open the game, and it's not really disruptive because they're waiting anyway.
Yeah, it's all about perfect placement.
Yeah. So,
you just got to test it.
Yeah. So,
speaking of testing, were you ready to talk about analytics?
Yes, okay. That's exactly what I was about to do.
Yeah, this is a great way to figure out how people are actually playing your game. So one of the best ways to figure out how to make the most revenue out of your game is to see where are people quitting, where are they moving to, what options are they choosing, who's actually playing my game. And analytics is a great way to do that. There's a couple different analytics packages out there. Mm-hmm. I personally like Flurry. Flurry's a free one. And it's just so simple to put in your game. If you want to show them how to add that to your game, that'd be great.
Yeah, so I'm over here on dev.flurry.com, and I went and created an account with my email, and you have to verify it, you know, like you normally do. So once you get past that part, you're over here to create a new application, and we're going to look at the awesome Windows phone, and then you can, you know, select the application for your name. I called this GameMaker. Test game. And then action and adventure. Oh, so one other thing that I should mention about the ads in your game is once you create the unit, you can go back and change the category if you want to change it to a different type of game or something so that it shows different ads and it can, you know, add to that experience. So create app. So now we have this unique application key, so we can go over, I'm going to copy this and put this into GameMaker.
Notice on that last screen that it said download the SDK. The great thing about GameMaker is it's already built in. They've already built Flurry into it, so you don't have to mess with any of that stuff.
That's awesome. Saves time. So we can go back into the change global game settings where we put in the advertising, and we'll go over to analytics on the right. It's right next to advertising if you got that part before. This time we're selecting Windows Phone, and we would do enable Flurry and paste in that Flurry ID that we have. And then there it is, it's in our game. So we'd be able to go back into our Flurry account later and see like the kind of traffic we're getting there.
So it takes about 3 days for the data to start coming. So you're always 3 days behind, but quite honestly, it's free. If we look at Dave in the Cave, since Dave's been out for a while, I want to show you what that simple thing she just did gives you. So right off the bat, when I open up my account, you can see Dave in the Cave. You can see a couple things that are really important for you. Unique users and active users. So how many different people have actually used your game at all, picked it up, and started playing it? And how many are continuing to play it at any time? How many sessions do they have?
That's a lot of people.
Yeah. I was awesome. Like I said, it was fun to make the game. I was very happy that people enjoyed it. I get 4 stars on most
wow.
platforms, 4.5 stars, I should say. And so if we start looking into here, you can see graphs on active users. You can see session frequencies. You can see number of sessions per user. You can see how many new users. And all this stuff I'm showing you right now, and let me actually go down here to show you even more stuff. Session length, I can see, and I'm not going to show you every little thing in here, but there's really some really cool stuff. User acquisition, Is it actually a new thing they have here? The technical stuff, like, well, what kind of phones are people using? You can see the Nokia Lumia 520, which is very popular in Europe. It's one of our low-cost phones out there. Is mostly on that. As I said before, I have it on Android and iOS as well, so you can see that Android actually takes up the rest of the top fives. You can dive in that to see how low it goes. You can see what carriers it's being used on. You can see what firmwares it's being used on. And so you can make decisions on changing the game, on adding to the game, on doing updates. If there's bug fixes, which one am I going to do first? You know, where are people having its pain points? It has other stuff like, actually,
did you make any changes to your game after seeing the analytics?
I have not. I have not yet. I know the things in my game that I'd like to change to make it better. You know, it's part of the learning process of doing it. But it just gives you just a wealth of information that you can dive into. And all of this came, all of that I'm showing you, there's a little bit more that I'm going to share with you, but all of the stuff that I'm showing you right now is all stuff that came from you just plugging in that ID. Mm-hmm. Flurry out of the box gives you all this stuff. I'm trying to find one.
Which one are you looking for?
I think
for?
It's audience. This one's really cool. Interests and categories. So Flurry is on a lot of different apps, not just games apps. I don't know why this isn't showing personas, maybe. There we go. That's what I was looking for. So you can see what types of people are using your games. And this might be a little bit more applicable to a non-game, because you can see casual and social gamers is off the chart for this one. And so Flurry's on a lot of different apps, so they're able to gather information on what types of apps people have on their phones in addition to mine that are also using Flurry. So we get all of this out of the box. You can see photo and video enthusiasts or social influencers. And so you can start targeting based on all this information. Again, all of this is out of the box. Another thing you can do is really get targeted on what you want to know. So if you want to know specific stuff, if we go back to Dave in the cave, and I do scripts and search in scripts, I think I have something called Flurry in there. let's see, this one maybe. So whatever you want to track. So I wanted to track a bunch of things. I wanted to track when someone went to another level, to see how far they got, to see who's getting to level 15. Are they quitting at level 14? Is 12 too hard? I have another one in here where I want to see, actually after level 11, I ask them to review it. And so I wanted to see whether they're saying yes to the review or no to the review and what frequency. So all through here, I'm setting things very specific to what I want to know. And all I do is do analytics event, and I say the type, and I give it a couple parameters. And then I'm able to, in Flurry, if we go back there, look at this technical stuff. I'm sorry, events. So events are mine. Game progress, showed ratings, so I wanted to know when they actually saw the ratings. That told me a bunch of stuff. It told me that they got to the level. And then whether when I showed them to rate it, whether they declined it, whether they declined it and said, don't show me again, because I gave them that option. And I can dive into each one of these to see different levels. So the game progress tells me what level they went to, and we can actually look at that and dive through, and there's a bunch of charts to show me what levels they've gotten to and how far. So very simple to use, and it's something that you have to put in your game. You saw how simple it was. It's something that you don't want to miss in your game.
Yeah, there's so much information there. That's definitely helpful as a developer.
Absolutely.
So that was everything we had for that module. We talked about advertising and analytics. So we'll be back in a couple minutes to go on with the next module.
See ya. Welcome welcome back to Module 4 of Building a 2D Game with GameMaker Advanced Techniques. In this section, we're going to talk about touchscreen controls and saving your data. Now, I know in my game, to actually make it work the way I wanted to do, I needed touch controls. You had a artichoke and mushroom game?
Mysterious mushrooms
game. And you implemented some touch controls in your game, right?
Yes, I did. I have the, you can touch to shoot.
Yeah, it's a very interesting part of game development is really deciding the touch controls you have. I've probably implemented four different types, testing them back and forth, and it's something you really have to think about depending on what your game is. You need to make it easy to use because most of the time, like your game, like my game, it's on a mobile device. If you're doing it on a PC, you know, that's easy. You can do, you know, mouse controls or maybe keyboard controls. But when you're on a mobile device, if you're on a phone or a pad, you really need them to just be able to use their finger. So we're going to talk about doing touchscreen controls today. So we're going to start with control buttons and an easy way to do control buttons. We're going to also then talk about swipe. You know, one of the easiest ways to control characters is by doing swipes, and I'll show you how to do that in a game. And then at the end, we're going to tack on, as you're going through your game, you want to be able to save some data locally that has to do with your game, what level they've gotten to, what things they've captured, what keys they have, how much gold they have, etc. And so you need to know how to do that. So we're gonna touch on that. So let's start by talking about adding touch controls to your game. Okay, the first thing I'm gonna do is I want to share this with you again so you can follow along. We have a bunch of starter kits. You can find them at aka.ms GM starter kits. And if you download those, there's a wealth of information in those that allow you to get started. Some of the stuff we're going to be showing you in these last two modules come from those. And in those, you'll find three different starter kits, the platform, the maze, the endless runner, with some documentation as well. So if I look at and run the platform one, let me pop that open and run that. We'll let that come up here a second. You can see that I could, right now I'm using the keyboard to do stuff in this game, but I can also have these touch controls. Now, these aren't probably the best placement in the world for touch controls, but it is a good demo. It's a good way to show you what's going on. You can see I can do left, I can click on right, and I can do up, down, Z to jump. And X would be to shoot, although this guy doesn't shoot on this level. And so all of these work the same way as the keyboard input does. Now, these are big, blocky buttons. Yours would probably look a little better, but you'll see the point. So let me go ahead and close this and then show you how you put that in. And where that's actually located in the starter kit is this Object Windows Features. We'll look at that more in the next module. But let's open this up. In here, we have different pieces of code. And in here, let's first look at, I think it's under room start, is what we call virtual keys. Now, virtual keys allow you to designate a section on the screen that when it is pressed, something happens. The important thing to note about virtual keys, and something that's very important, is that this is not going to show anything. This is just designating XY coordinates on the screen, so when a user presses there, something happens. Here, I'm setting different keys to different places on the screen. You can see the coordinates I'm setting here, and then I'm assigning it a key. So I'm assigning this one left, I'm assigning this one up, I'm assigning this one down, and you know, on down. I can set not just a key like a VK right, but I can actually designate a specific key on the keyboard. And what that's going to do is it's going to map it. Since I already have in my program, I have the left, right, Z, X keys already mapped to do specific stuff, move the player left, move the player right. It's going to piggyback on top of that. But if I just left my game like this and let people play the game, they would have no idea how to move. You actually have to show them something. So what you do then is you want to draw onto the screen. And that's pretty simple. If I just go in this is on the object properties of the object windows features object, you'll notice that right here I'm drawing rectangles. So you can get a lot more creative with this. You can create a really cool game pad, which is what I did at the beginning. But these are just very large rectangles that are the exact same coordinates as those virtual keys. So right here, I'm drawing the rectangles. And right here, we're setting color. And then right here, we're actually putting text on them so they know exactly what to do, the up, the down, the left, the right. And so if we run this one more time, you can see that it very simply gives them the ability to play this on a phone, to play on a tablet, wherever they want to do it. So easy to implement. Now, if we open up this other starter kit, and this is the Endless Runner. Again, we can use keyboard controls. And I can jump over the cactus, see if we made it in time. Oh, let me try it one more time. We can shoot, we can crouch, we can jump. And while I like this, it kind of lends itself to swiping. So there's a lot of different games that allow you to